invite folks to mute.
Good morning and welcome on this Pentecost Visioning Sunday, when we remember the promise that the young shall see visions and the old will dream dreams. So no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. I'd like to invite you to find the announcements that are at the back of your bulletin under Community Happenings. Today is the day for the Strengthen the Church offering. There's an envelope in your bulletin to use, or you can give online or mail your offering into the church office. This helps local churches and conferences, so please support this offering. Every Monday, you will be receiving a church survey in your inbox. Please open it and fill it out. This is a huge gift to give to your church as we prepare to search for a new pastor. Yes?
What I want to say is, if you've already completed it and you get another email, it doesn't mean you have to do it again.
Right.
You only have to do it once.
Just one time. And every member of your household who's engaged in the ministry of this church. So, you know, if the husband fills it out, that does not take care of it for the partner or child. You know, everybody should fill it out. Also, we're excited that Noah Brewer Wallen will be preaching for us on our first Pride Sunday, June 16th. On the, let's see, there's a third annual Porch Fest, Sunday, June 2nd. at 11 a.m. on the church lawn, so that sounds like that's going to be really great. Are there other announcements that need to come to our attention? Oh, friendship registers, my goodness. So you see Rick is holding up a friendship register, and he's going to show you where to find them in your pews. Right there. And actually, if you don't mind doing this now, pick out your friendship register, sign your name. We are especially glad to get emails if you need to update your email. If you're new among us, please share that. Also, if there are other concerns that you would like to share, if you'd like a pastoral visit, if there's some other communication, just mark it down on the friendship register. Rick and I always look at these on Sunday afternoon so that we can follow up and make sure that your concerns have been addressed. So thank you for helping us out with the friendship registers. Other announcements? All right. Well, please stand if you are able and let us join together in the call to worship. Come, the Spirit of God is being poured out on all people, young and old, rich and poor, believers and skeptics. A new creation is coming to all people. As arid paths are renewed with water, dreams are ignited with fire, new visions are stirred by the wind, and seeds of hope are again planted in the earth and in our lives. Let us pray together. Come among us again, Almighty God, filling us with your Spirit and power to experience and bear witness to your redeeming love. Amen. And let us sing, Let Every Christian Pray. Seated. Our lesson for today is from Acts 2, verses 1 through 21, the story of Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place, and suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven living in Jerusalem. And at this sound, the crowd gathered and was bewildered because each one heard them speaking in the native language of each. Amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in our own native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt, and parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabs, in our own languages, we hear them speaking about God's deeds of power. All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you, and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams, even upon my slaves, both men and women. And in those days I will pour out my spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show portents in the heaven above, and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and smoky mist. The sun shall be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the Lord's great and glorious day. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." Here ends the reading.
Amen, and thank you. And let us pray. Holy Spirit, come again. Fill our ears with the sound of your breath. Fill our eyes with the brilliance of your presence in each other. And fill our hearts with your good word. Amen. Friends, it is an exercise of imagination that we see one another as children of God and thus as brothers and sisters. In his book, Imagined Communities, Professor of Political Science Benedict Anderson has traced the development of nationalism and the triumph of imagination, and the triumph of imagination that sustains a connection for which people will die. He says, the nation is an imagined political community. It is imagined because the members of even the smallest nation will never know most of their fellow members. And yet, in the minds of each lives the image of their communion. You know, if I do not share a mother, a grandfather with you, if I do not share a religion with you, a language, why would I send a child to fight for this imagined us? When Stephen Colbert spoke of the Colbert Nation, our laughter imaginatively united us. Or when seeing someone last week in Boston wearing a UNC shirt, it was logical, in my mind, to speak to them. You know, likewise, when we in the church say, oh, we are the body of Christ, we are brothers and sisters in Christ, we are extending our theological imagination. When Jesus comes preaching, the reign of God has come near, it is an imagined community. You know, not imaginary, imagined. You know, you've expanded your world. The evolution and the expansion of the membership of that community, you know, is the story of the church. Jesus came preaching, the community of God has come near to those in the center and to those on the margins, those full of life and those at the edge of death, in sickness and in health, with the righteous and the unrighteous alike. And in so doing, he is reimagining the kingdom of God. Or you look at Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles. He confronts three major boundaries of his world: Jew-Gentile, male-female, slave-free. And reimagines those received boundaries as no more. With theological imagination, we continue reimagining that the community of God has come near, and we act accordingly. When the first Pentecost reimagines the people of God as from every nation under heaven, we should not be surprised when outsiders, strangers, enter the church. You know, others are integral to our identity, and yet the church has had to wrestle, struggle, imagine, reimagine, and loving God, love ourselves into existence again and again and again. Christopher Promuk is an associate professor of theology at Xavier in Cincinnati, good Jesuit school. And he's the author of a book, Hope Sings, So Beautiful, Graced Encounters Across the Color Line, in which he writes, racism is the symptom of a profound poverty, a terrible captivity of theological imagination. A disease of imagination calls for responses that nourish, free, and enlarge the imagination. You know, it's not just black-white racism that disfigures the imagination. The war in Ukraine has divided families into communities of Russian speakers and Ukrainian speakers. Commencement speakers here in the States in 2024 are still defining what traditional roles for women may be. Political discourse in our country too easily devolves into who is a real American. Well, for the good news of Jesus to remain good, every age and time needs to nourish, free, and enlarge imagination. The work of Christian unity is not the work of sacred negotiators parsing words, but the joy of reimagining life together as new and better. You know, faith is the process by which we nourish, free, and enlarge imagination. You know, the protest singer Phil Ochs once wrote that in such an ugly time, true protest is beauty. Well, friends, in a world burdened, even threatened by the profound poverty, a terrible captivity of theological imagination, we have a beautiful story of togetherness and unity in Pentecost. Imagine that a different world is possible. It is an imaginative faith and protest that sees hope in a child born in the muck of a stable. It is an imaginative faith and protest that sees hope in a teacher preaching to the untouchables, the demoniacs, those outside of the halls of power. It is imaginative faith and protest that sees hope in a cross, an instrument of terror. You know, may the Spirit fall on us anew as we reimagine our vision for serving God in Boxborough and use the gift of imagination to faithfully include, repair, and redeem the people of God's creation, our brothers and sisters. May it be so, and thanks be to God. Amen. As we gather for prayer, I just like to ask for concerns that you may have on here, and then joys. So I'll start with concerns that people may have. Yes. Concerns? No? Yes?
Continue prayers for Paul to follow.
Continue prayers for Paul to follow.
She was in her 50s and she had an aneurysm and Larissa. Her name is Angel.
Oh.
She was very much about her church family and community.
She lived up to her name.
She certainly did.
Wonderful. Any joys that the people like to share? Oh, come on, don't everybody rush to say, the visiting meeting. No.
Well, I'm seeing in the bulletin that it's your anniversary. So
yeah. Well, thank you.
We had a wonderful, soggy, breezy, cold day from summer, and then we every Saturday from now until whenever it is.
Yes, please.
It's my first time in church with me and my family since the pandemic started.
I was
a very young Christian for that time.
Wonderful. Yes.
But this is Pastor Lee. I went down to Rhode Island to my daughter's high school choir band. And I have to tell myself, there are good people, there are good things happening in this world.
Yes.
To listen to the news, especially things that were cropping up this week. It was so disheartening. It was good to just see some joyful young adults, hopefully on the right track, that can make good decisions as long as we need.
Just a joy. One of the stuff, all the kids who I've seen and with their parents posting pictures of their graduations and from college, like Emmett from our congregation and some others, to start the next chapter in your life. For.
The joy of graduation, yes.
A joy that our family walked in the NAMI walk in Boston, and Boston Common yesterday, and there were thousands of people that joined us. And this is the big annual fundraising for NAMI, and they exceeded their goal by 10%.
Wow.
It was really a good day.
The NAMI walk yesterday exceeded its goal. Yes, please.
My niece was graduating from high school, and we actually going to UConn.
Oh, wonderful. More graduates. Yes.
Online, we have one from Larry S. saying that his good friend Jim and wife Kathy, who lost their cousin to suicide this past week.
Yes.
Prayers for my hairdresser, Melissa, who had a stillborn baby. Prayers for her family.
Yeah, I will say that, Jill and I will be away part of the early part of the week. We typically take a few days and go off to celebrate our anniversary. It's been 46 years. Wonderful. And we also have a sadness in our I guess, extended family or community in that by the end of the week, we will be in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. The woman who served as the maid of honor, as Jill's maid of honor, died. She was, we of course knew her from Yale Divinity School, and she served in churches in Connecticut and in Rhode Island, and then ended her career serving churches in Bethlehem. So, M. Finney was her name. Well, let us come together in prayer. Gracious God, we ask that in this silence that you hear now the concerns that were spoken and those that were unspoken in our hearts. Concerns for Paul and Cheryl, concerns for Susan's father, for Lawrence, for Angel, for Larry. We ask you to share in the joy of Freebie and visiting family and friends of graduates and choirs and successful walks. O living God, with wondrous works and mighty deeds, you continue to astound us with your grace and power. Like the rush of a mighty wind, you make your presence known, interrupting our complacency, disturbing our lethargy. Fill us with your Spirit and enlarge our vision. Open our eyes to the future that awaits. No misconnections, no broken speech, no failures of hearing. Fill with your Spirit all of us, that we may grow in grace and be strengthened by your love for the task of discipleship and service. And fill us with your Spirit, that we may pray as Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Creator God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you now to come with your gifts. We remember the phrase from Psalm 104, when you open your hand, they are filled with good things. So much of our life is the gratitude, gratitude for what has been received, and then our emulating that same grace and generosity. Come, open your hands. And let us pray together. We praise you with joy, God, and commit ourselves and our gifts to the sharing of life-giving good news. May we be equipped to preach the faith in word and deed. Amen. And now you're invited to join in a hymn that I believe you'll find familiar. It's one that accompanied your Opening Doors campaign that was written by Larry. It's printed on page 4, but you'll find it with the music on page 8, the final page of your bulletin.
Now, before we hear the benediction, I would like to say that we purposely had a shortened service this morning because you're invited now to go and quickly, did I mention quickly, get a cup of coffee, a cookie, and then come back, for then our moderator would like to start the annual visioning meeting. And so that will happen, you know, immediately after worship. After you've gotten your coffee, come right back in. So, friends, Jesus did not leave us without hope, but sent the Spirit to nurture faith and love in the world. And in all that you do, respond to rancor with kindness, be patient where there is pain, and let your dreams become a reality. And may the steadfast love of God, the grace of Christ, and the power of the Holy Spirit fill you with a zeal for justice and a passion for peace, now and always. Amen.